Hi guys, this is Jordan with Motion Array. When you watch a movie, you may not realize how much work actually goes into making sure that that movie has a very specific feel. Everything from set design to camera choices, casting and lenses, it all makes an impact on how that movie feels. And one of the easiest ways to replicate that feeling is by replicating the color. Well, think about it. We all know that this greenish wash is trying to replicate the Matrix, or that this more desaturated look is trying to replicate a post-apocalyptic world, or that this teal and orange look is trying to replicate, well, pretty much everybody else. So today, we're gonna learn how to get these three basic effects right inside of Premiere Pro, and we're gonna go over them from easiest to hardest. So jump inside Premiere and let's learn how to get these effects together.
But to start it off, I need to say that while you can get this look inside of Premiere, there are more powerful free tools out there to help you achieve a greater specificity of your color grade. Specifically, DaVinci Resolve has a very powerful free version, and if you have access to the entire Creative Cloud suite, then you can actually use Photoshop to create lookup tables, or LUTs, to then use in Premiere Pro later on. But for right now, we're going to stay inside of Premiere. The first thing you want to do is make sure that you have your footage on your timeline ready to edit. Now, here's something that might sound obvious, but it still needs to be said. The color edit is going to be heavily influenced by what's actually in your shot. For example, if there's no blue or orange in your shot, you're not really going to experience the full benefits of the teal-orange color grade. So be conscious not only of your color grade, but what's actually in your shot as well. So let's start simple and go for the basic desaturated look, followed by the Matrix look, and then the teal-orange color grade. To start off, if you want to have a simple drag and drop solution, each of these looks has a built-in preset or multiple presets that can kind of get you towards the look you're going for. Go down to the Creative section, and you'll see that under Look, there's a variety of presets that you can choose from. Three examples that come close to the ideals that we're looking for are Hsl Bleach HDR, then Hsl Matrix Green, surprise, surprise, and finally Hsl Blue Ice. You can use these as starting points or simply as a substitute if you have no time to put into this. But we're going to go more in-depth and create each look from scratch. Take your footage and highlight it, then go over to Lumetri Color. The first thing that we want to do is lower our saturation. But believe it or not, we're not done. One of the things that's central to this look is, yes, the lack of color, but surprisingly, a lot of brown that creeps into the image. So we're going to do two things. We're going to go down to our shadows of our three-wheel color corrector here and push the shadows into this brown area here a little bit. Great! We're starting to get there. Now we're going to go to our curve section and give it a little bit more of a moody feel. It's post-apocalyptic, so chances are you're going to want things to look a little bit edgy. Bring down the shadows a little bit, and then raise up the highlights. Your personal taste might vary, but the idea of a post-apocalyptic world is that there's not really a lot of beauty lighting. Things are harsh, but you also still want your film to feel good to look at, so you'll need to strike a bit of a balance. Lastly, let's bring out some more of the browns here by going down to our saturation curve, where we can isolate a particular color to saturate. And for us, it's going to be this area with a brown in it. Make two little dots on either side and then raise up this bit in the middle. Raise it up just a tad to give your film a little bit more of a muddy look. Now that you have this basic look down, play around with the saturation again to see what looks best for your shot. And what I find also helps is to pull up a reference image for a film that you're trying to emulate. Then take a look every so often and see if you're getting closer to or farther away from that feel. And with that, we're done. And the color correction looks decent, but it's just me in a room. So let's check out what it looks like on a couple other examples. Next, for the greenish matrix style look, let's start by going down here to our three-wheel color corrector. We're going to go down to our shadows here, and this is where we're going to be doing most of our green pushing. Believe it or not, the matrix look isn't exclusively green. If you look at a variety of still frames from the movie, you may be able to tell that the green actually has a little bit of blue in it. Most likely this was done to help give the movie a bit of a colder feel, as, spoiler alert, the idea is that the world of the Matrix is virtual, computer created, and therefore a cold representation of humanity without that human warmth. Green can mean a lot of different things too. Do you mean chroma green, teal, lime green, forest green? So when they were coloring the footage, the creators had a lot of different options available to them. And one of the priorities was depriving the world of the Matrix from that feeling of being truly human. To help emphasize this, giving it a bit of a slightly colder look will help achieve that more lifeless feel. So, we're going to be bringing the green in the shadows area here down into the greens, but also pushing it a little bit into the blue. To help keep the skin tones from getting too greenish blue, we're also going to move the midtones here a little bit into the orange section, and the highlights similarly, but even to a lesser degree. Now, we can play around with the sliders on the side here to control how bright each of these respective sections are. The Matrix is a dark world, so we're going to drop the shadows here a little bit, and then drop the midtones just a touch, and then raise up the highlights just a little bit. Next, we're going to go all the way up to basic color corrections and make the color temperature a little bit colder. Then finally, drop the saturation a little bit, and we're left with this, our Matrix look. Let's see how it looks on some other footage. Now, for the teal and orange look, we're going to be going in depth a little more than average. To start off with, I'm just going to up the saturation a little bit. And then, we're going to completely neglect everything else and go all the way down to Hsl Secondary. What this section is basically a secondary correction that goes on top of your overall color correction. What's amazing here is that we can isolate a particular color and then make changes to it specifically. So here we're going to go and take the eyedropper and highlight the skin color of our subject. And you can see here that our selection has been now applied to these sliders over here. Now what we're going to do is go down to this box that says color/gray and highlight it. Now what you should see is that a range of color has been selected, and the color that you can see is the color that can have changes applied to it, and everything else that's grayed out can't. So right now our goal is to have as much skin color highlighted with as little background selected as possible. Here we can move around our sliders by grabbing the middle. Expand or contract them by using this triangle, or give it a little bit more or less roll-off with this slider here. And we can do this for all three categories, the hue, the saturation, and the luminance, which is why it's called HSL. So we can start here by encompassing all of the skin hue that we can possibly get, and we can see that in our example, we don't really have any trouble keeping it separate from the background, but we can't get all of the skin color in. So now it's time to move on to the second slider, saturation. Here, different saturation amounts under the skin tone will be selected and can be either included or excluded from where we position the slider. The key is that there's no one-size-fits-all solution. You have to play around with it until you can find the situation that works best for your footage. But my suggestion would be to move the slider in both directions and see where the central point of focus should be. Then, either expand or contract it in order to get a larger or smaller selection, and then roll off from there. Lastly, the luminance will control the brightness and darkness of the areas that are included or excluded within this one tone. This is the section you can use to try and get those bright white sections. Here, the lights are interacting really harshly with my face and leaving a lot of bright patches. Be careful that you keep as much of the background excluded as possible. Now, with that done, you have two more options here called denoise and blur. Increasing denoising will help to cut off any small sections that have poking through that you don't want to be included. You can see some very small sections of the tiles in the background are poking through. Denoising will help that a little bit. And then the blur will give an overall fade to your selection so that it's more gradual. This will also help to get rid of harsh, sharp, and even pixelated edging. So, with that, deselect your gray option here, and this is what you should be left with. Absolutely no change. But if you go down here to the color wheel, you should be able to play around with it and see that any changes you make here affect only the skin tone. And the isolation is actually pretty successful. So here we can make isolated changes to just the skin color. And you can totally choose to go down that route. But personally, I actually like to do it this way. Take the selection you just made with your color and invert it by pressing this button here. What's the result? Now you can control everything except for the skin tone. I really prefer this because skin tones can be really tricky. Too much change and you can start to look like an alien or like you're very, very sick. But by working with the background and pushing it now towards the blues, we can contrast our skin color by comparison and help to bring it out by simply making it stand out from the background. For even more control, select the three color wheel option here and then go down, trying to keep the shadows where most of the blue is being pushed. Now there we can already see a teal and orange contrast just by focusing on the background. So now all we have to do is stylize it and make it look a little bit more natural. Go back to your basic color correction, and I like to take the entire color temperature down a little bit, and then try pushing the saturation up just a tad. Then give it a little bit of life with the curves. Here I'm raising the highlights up and dipping the shadows down. And finally, you can also isolate the saturation of your skin tones in particular by using this hue saturation curve. The skin tones should be in this general section here. Personally, I'm pretty white, or really pale orange if you want to get technical, but no matter what your skin color is, they should all be located in this general region of the color wheel. This is also why the blue-teal contrast works regardless of who you are, because all of the skin tones match up to be on the opposite side of the color wheel from blue. Pretty neat, right? So click to make two little dots on either side of this region, and then make one more to either lift up or drop down the color, depending on the look that you're going for. You don't have to make a very big change at all. Just a little bit more intensity in the skin tone or a little bit more reserved. Personally, I'm just gonna push it up just a hair. And lastly, I'm just gonna re-emphasize all of the changes that we made by doing some very minor pushes in our normal color wheels. This is not the Hsl color wheels. And with that, we have our classic teal and orange look, all inside of Premiere. It takes a little bit more effort than with some of the other tutorials you may have seen floating around, but we think that it gives a more versatile look to your color if you don't want to jump into another program. But there's one last thing. You may have created each of these looks and thought that it looks like what you're going for, but it's just a little too much, too intense, and you need to bring it back. A simple solution that works for any look is to duplicate your footage and place it directly on top of the original. Now, go to the bottom layer and go to Effect Controls and delete your Lumetri Color Adjustment. At this point, you should see no change. But now, if you decrease the opacity of your top clip, you'll see it start to lower the intensity globally across your color changes. So you can drop it down to 75% opacity, and you've effectively reduced the intensity of your color correction by 25%. Neat, right? So to wrap it up, let's see how our color grade looks on some other footage. So there you have it, guys. Three classic film looks that you can get right inside of Premiere Pro. I hope you found this video helpful. If you did, we've got tons of other tutorials that you can check out over at motionarray.com. Thank you so much for watching, and I hope to see you in the next video.